Hare Krishna. Question: which are the important commentaries on the Srimad Bhagavatam apart from Srila Prabhupada's? Answer: there are many commentaries. The standard reference or standard compilation of Sanskrit commentaries on the Srimad Bhagavatam is a compilation published by Krishna Sankar Shastri, which takes together the commentaries of 12 prominent acharyas, 12 prominent scholars, and among them also some are considered prominent, and I'll list some of them over here and explain a bit about their commentaries. So in the in English, as of now, for the full Bhagavatam, Srila Prabhupada's is the only commentary. Right? In Sanskrit, the Bhagavatam is the only Purana which has attracted dozens and dozens of commentaries. There are, the Bhagavad Gita is a relatively small book, 700 verses, and commenting on it is not very difficult. So it has attracted hundreds upon hundreds of commentaries in Sanskrit. You could say even thousands of commentaries. The Bhagavatam is huge, thousands and thousands of verses. So commenting on the full Bhagavatam is a Herculean task. And among the various Puranas, it is the Bhagavatam alone has attracted many, many commentaries. None of the other Puranas, even Vishnu Purana, which is considered very important in the Shri Sampradaya, has not attracted more than a few commentaries. Few means less than 10 also. So the Bhagavatam has attracted dozens and dozens of commentaries. And Srila Prabhupada also, right in the first chapter, his commentary in the Bhagavatam states that the serious student should study the commentaries of the previous acharyas. So, now coming to the commentaries, the most important commentary, which is more or less defined the way subsequent commentators have commented, that is the commentary of Sridhar Swami. Now, the exact date of Sridhar Swami is not known. He is roughly, probably 13th, 14th century, something like that. By the time Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared, his commentary had become very respectable. So respectable, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu considered it the seminal authority. So, in that sense, he must have lived at least 100, 200 years before, because at that time, there was not so much, traveling would take time, and for a book's fame to spread far and wide, people had to, the book itself had to be taken from one place to another, it had to be handwritten, there was no other way at that time. So, there is no accurate date available, but he wrote a commentary, Bhavartha Deepika. Now, Deepa is a lamp. And Deepika is a small lamp. So the title itself reflects the mood as well as the content of Sridhar Swami's commentary. Deepika is a small light, and Sridhar Swami, right at the start as well as the end of the Bhagavatam, expresses humility by stating that actually, who am I to comment on the Bhagavatam? Bhagavatam is like a is like the Vandara mountain, and even the gods struggle to lift it up. So what can I lift it up? But I pray to the Lord's mercy, and I am writing this commentary not to exhibit my scholarship, but simply to relish the Bhagavatam. So his mood is very humble. This is a small torchlight, and his commentary is also very concise. He focuses primarily on clarifying the meanings of complex Sanskrit words and gives some clarifies some concepts, and wherever things are not clear in what the Bhagavatam is saying, he gives a contextual interpretation. So Sridhar Swami nominally belonged to the Advaitic Sampradaya, and so on a few occasions he gives, if the context seems to be supporting impersonalism, he gives impersonal commentaries, but overall his commentary is highly devotional. So devotional that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu considered it to be the most authoritative commentary. In fact, all other commentators have commented, have always, almost always referred to Sridhar Swami's commentary. Now, in the Gaudiya tradition itself, Sridhar Swami preceded the Gaudiya tradition, which began with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's appearance in the 15-16 centuries. So the first person to comment on the full Bhagavatam is Shri Jiva Goswami. Actually, he does not comment exactly on the full Bhagavatam verse by verse, although he has written a commentary called the Kramasandarbha, which deals with many of the verses of the Bhagavatam. It is called the running treatise. But he has already commented on most of the significant important themes and verses of the Bhagavatam in his Shatsandarbhas. So, Shatsandarbhas are primarily philosophical treatises that use the Bhagavatam's authority for substantiating both how Gaudiya Vaishnavism is based on Shastra and how Gaudiya Vaishnavism is based on Vedanta. So, what he does in the Shatsandarbha itself is a remarkable intellectual feat. But the important point is he comments on many of the Bhagavatam's concepts and verses over there. And so his comments on the Bhagavatam in the Kramasandarbha tend to be very brief. And it isn't in the Kramasandarbha, it is not necessarily comment on all the verses. So the first proper commentary in the Gaudiya Sampradaya on the Bhagavatam has been by Srinath Chakravarti Thakur, who wrote Chaitanya Manjusha. And the much more celebrated commentary in the Gaudiya Sampradaya on the Bhagavatam is by Vaishnava Chakravarti Thakur, who wrote his Sararth Darshini. So, the Darshini, Darshana is to reveal. So, Darshini is the revealer of essential meaning. And Vaishnava Chakravarti Thakur goes into the heart of the Bhagavatam often, deciphering and explaining the esoteric moods and the internal dialogues that go on and between the conversation is when the Bhagavatam uses only the external dialogues. So this is considered Rasacharya, and his commentary helps us to relish the Bhagavatam very greatly by understanding the subtleties, the nuances, and the relishable mellows that underlie the Bhagavatam. And apart from him, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur also wrote a commentary, but he wrote primarily on the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, which is the Uddhava Gita. He published the Uddhava Gita. So he published his own commentary along with Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur's commentary in the Uddhava Gita. And he commented on sections of the Bhagavatam, verses of the Bhagavatam also. And of course, our Sampradaya, Srila Prabhupada has commented in English on the Bhagavatam. Now, apart from our Sampradaya, I'll just mention a few commentators here. From the Gaudiya Sampradaya, I mentioned three commentators: Veera Raghava Acharya from the Madhva Sampradaya, then there is Veera Raghava Acharya from the Shri Sampradaya, the Vijayadvaja Tirtha from the Madhva Sampradaya, and Vallabha Acharya from the Pushti Marga. So now, if we look at the commentaries, Raghava Acharya wrote a commentary called the Bhagwat Chandra Chandrika. Bhagwat Chandra is compared, like we have Gaura Chandra or Krishna Chandra, the moon of Krishna, the moon of Lord Chaitanya. So Bhagwat Chandra is, he compares the Bhagavatam to a moon, and Chandrika is the moonlight. So the commentary makes, so the moon is far away, but what comes to us from the moon is the moonlight. So like that, the commentary is little difficult to understand, and the original text may be difficult to understand, but its meaning becomes accessible through the Chandrika. So the metaphor of light is often used. Metaphors are drawn from nature even while talking about titling the commentary. So Bhavarth Sararth Darshini, so Darshana, revelation, often is associated with light. So the revealer of the essential meaning, Bhavarth Deepika, that was the Swami's commentary. Bhavarth, the essential meaning, or the bhav, what is the emotional tenor, what is the meaning of the Bhagavatam, that will be illuminated. So here it is, Bhagavat Chandra Chandrika. And naturally, when a commentator from a particular sampradaya writes the commentary, then that commentator will focus on those things in the Bhagavatam which are important for in that tradition's philosophy, and those will be highlighted or will be emphasized, and accordingly the Bhagavatam will be explained. And then there is also Mr. Vijayadhvaja Tirtha, famous scholar and acharya in the Madhya Sampradaya, and he wrote a commentary called Padaratnavali. The word Pada means Pada is feet, but Pada is verses, and Ratnavali means a necklace of jewels, so necklace of jewel like verses. That is his commentary on the Shrimad Bhagavatam, and therein of course he explains things from the Madhva Sampradaya point of view. In the Madhva Sampradaya, Shri Madhvacharya wrote concise treatises. He wrote a Mahabharata Tatpari Nirnaya, where he gives the essential meaning of the Mahabharata, and he also gives Bhagavata Tatpari Nirnaya, where he gives the essential meaning of the Bhagavat. But he did not write a full commentary. And of course, Ramanujacharya did not write the commentary also on the Bhagavatam. So, these are the prominent Acharyas who have written in that Sampradaya. And now, as far as the prominent Acharyas in Sampradaya are considered, Vallabhacharya is considered to be the the founder of a distinct tenor within the Uddha Sampradaya. So, therein he started what is called the Pushti Marga, with the focus on the Vatsalya Bhava. So, he wrote a commentary called the Subodhini, and often his commentary is quite complex and goes into elaborate technical analysis on various occasions. And he focuses on Subodhini, as it means the right meaning. So, he also illumines the meaning of various sections in the Bhagavatam. Now, in the Bhagavatam, nearly the biggest canto by far is the 10th canto. And that is what is the most beloved section of the whole Bhagavatam. And actually the 10th canto itself has attracted various kinds of commentaries. So, the verse by verse commentaries which it has attracted in our tradition are by two prominent Acharyas. One is Sanatana Goswami, who wrote Brihad Vaishnava Toshani. So, where he comments on each verse of the Bhagavatam and of the Bhagavatam, and he reveals many, many wonderful things in the Bhagavatam. Many pastimes he explains and he analyzes in a very relishable way. And he reconciles certain things where the Bhagavatam's narrative seems to contradict that in the Mahabharata or in the other Puranas, and where certain things are not illumined in the Bhagavatam, he also brings this extensive research from the other Puranas and puts the pastimes often in the chronological order when they are themselves spoken more in a trance, in spurti, and are not necessarily chronological. So, and then Jeev Goswami has written the Gopal Champu. Kavi Karanapur has written Anandam Jampu, which are not exactly commentaries in the Bhagavatam's 10th canto, but they are retellings of the 10th canto, where rather than going by verse by verse, there is a free-flowing narrative of the 10th canto, which is done, which basically, both these books are masterpieces of poetry, and they are filled with literary metaphors, and they are great samples of Sanskrit poetry. So, they are Kavya. They fall in the category of Kavya. Champu basically is a special literary composition where there is a combination of poetry and prose. So, that's why if you read especially the Gopal Champu in translation, when it has been translated properly by say we have Hanuman Maharaj's translation, there you will see two numberings. So, one set of numberings, maybe it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and suddenly another starts 1, 2, 3, 4, and then it will go on to 6, 7, 8, and then it will be 5, 6, 7. That's because the prose has a particular numbering and the poetry has a particular numbering, and they intersperse. Now, there are rules about how the poetry and prose can intersperse in the Champu, and in Gopal Champu, Jeev Goswami uses that form of composition to glorify Lord Krishna's 10th canto pastimes. Now, Anandandavan Champu is shorter, and it focuses primarily on the Vrindavan pastimes of Krishna. And along with this, so the retelling of the Bhagavatam could be compared something like to something like Srila Prabhupada's Krishna book. What Gopal Champu and Anandavan Champu are doing, they are retelling the 10th canto. So it's not a verse by verse commentary, but a free flowing narrative. Now, Prabhupada, of course, gives much more philosophical import to make the 10th canto intelligible to the modern audience. Gopal Anandavan Champu does not give much philosophy, although a little bit comes up. Gopal Champu does give not so much philosophy, but analysis and explanation of the pastime in terms of explaining questions that may come up when one hears the pastime. And he develops the characters very beautifully, so that we come to know about the background and the moods of those characters who are just described, or the moods and backgrounds are described only very briefly in the Bhagavatam. And another, the verse by verse commentary, another that was written by in the our sampradayas, the Vaishnav Nandini commentary by Shri Baldev Vidyabhushan. So Vaishnav Nandini refers to that which gives joy to the Vaishnava. So this is a commentary written by Baldev Vidyabhushan, and herein he comments on the beauty of the Srimad Bhagavatam, especially the 10th canto, and he elaborates on what the previous acharyas have given. So in this way, this is just a small sample of the many commentaries that are there. And the important point is that we all have abandoned opportunity to absorb ourselves in the Bhagavatam and relish the Bhagavatam. And then, as the Bhagavatam itself promises, yadra samritruptasya nanyatra syadati kvachet. And once we get a taste for the Bhagavatam, then all worldly taste, they will no longer taste appealing. And we will become detached from the world and absorbed in Krishna. Thank you.